A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajeem, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salati wa salam ashrafil mursaleen, Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bi madadakum wa nazarakum, ya Sayyidi ya Rasulul Kareem, ya Habib al-Azeem, ana abdukal ajeezu da'eefu miskeenu zalimu jahal, fa'ati Allah, ati Rasul, ulul amri minkum. Always a reminder for myself, my weakness, ana abdukal ajeezu da'eefu miskeenu zalimu jahal. And but for the grace of Allah that we are still in existence. Alhamdulillah, in this holy month of Rabbil Awwal, and that every day of our life is a Milad al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that at every moment is the celebration of the beatific reality and the birth and the love of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not one day. That one day is the immensity of importance to open the Divine reality within the heart. But for ashiqeen, at every moment is a reminder of that love, because it's a station of faith that Prophet described, that you have to love me more than you love yourself. So alhamdulillah, the love of Sayyidina Muhammad must overtake everything within our existence and must be the supreme love, the love of our life, the love and the purpose of our direction, is that Allah to be pleased with us. And by Allah to be pleased with us is to love Sayyidina Muhammad ﷺ, not to spend our life trying to prove the validity of the birthday, it's insulting, that's enough. You know, you do that once in your life and you never mention that again, but to continuously have to say that as if you're trying to validate for your own mind. So you're not even reaching the way of marifah, the way of Islam, the way of iman, and wa maqam al-ihsan. So this love and the immensity of the love is beyond imagination, that the reality of Sayyidina Muhammad is the treasure of Allah, and anyone seeking knowledges and ilma laduni wa hikmati bi saliheen, it resides within the heart and the reality of Sayyidina Muhammad, that we are on the third lunar month, and by the power of the Sultanate of Nine and its reality, only Allah take us on this journey through the Nines. And this is the 27th surah, Surah An-Naml, the ant. And the immensity of that reality of this Sultanate, that what we're trying to reach to, it's interesting that the surah of this marifah is an ant. You know, not like a lion, not a giraffe, not a Batman, anything huge, but Allah saying, you know, the reality and the immensity of the reality is in something so small that their concept of trying to talk about an atom before that term was brought out was the word of an ant. When you wanted to describe something so small that it's not so visible, not these big huge ants, but they're ants that look microscopic. And Allah drawing our attention that in this way of marifah, stop with all the sort of deep realities and just the basic reality, that this ant in this surah has an amazing reality. And when the armies of Sayyidina Sulaiman were marching, the ant screamed out to all the fellow ants of its kingdom, "O ants, enter your homes, for the armies of Sulaiman are marching." So one, it tells us that the animal kingdom has an immense power of communication, far stronger than ours. We just now got to the technology of email. So what type of technology Allah has given to them that they're able to communicate in such a way, in such a frequency because it can't be audible sound because nobody hears it. In other words, you'd hear screaming of a little ant and then all the ants would run. So it's not something through lisan, but through its energy and what Allah gave of its reality, it was able to communicate with all. Didn't have mobile phones from Japan, didn't have any technical devices, but Allah draws our attention, see this smallest creature, because وَلَكَ الْكَرَانَ بَنِي آدَمْ, that in this way of marifa they're describing all these magnificent gifts that Allah is giving to this creation of Adam and Eve and their children. But Allah has also given immense gifts to all of creation, and we're not able to achieve these realities, and we can't even achieve the rank of an ant, in which the ant was able to communicate with all of its community, enter into your homes. And immediately the ants went. So anytime we want to harm a creature and Allah's creation, a reminder that they have a communication system, they have a love, they have a muhabbat, they have a way of worshipness to Allah by their mere presence and service. Means they serve Allah with whatever Allah has commanded of them, and this draws the way of marifa, that in this immense month and this immense reality. And salam to all those whom are live with us, we see their comments and we always see the comments, and I'll address you, bless you, share the feed and share to people that you love and people that you don't love, make no distinction. But the immensity of this reality in this month, and entering into this Divinely Presence and the spectacular lights of Milad al-Nabi opening, because we're entering into this Divinely Heart. The next month is going to be 36, and 36 is Surat Yaseen, which is the heart of Qur'an, manzil of Qur'an, the immense power station in which Qur'an is emanating from that reality. So as we're journeying through the holy surah and is dressing this way of marifa, Surat An-Naml is teaching us that this ant, which side is the head? So this was, Mawlana always loved this topic of the ant, because you can't tell which side is the head. They look the same from both sides and it's very small. And that us and humans and insan with all this big head is not able to accomplish anything. We can't telepathically tell anybody go into their homes, we can't communicate with our energy without significant training. But this is a dalil in Qur'an of one, Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhis salam could hear them. If you think Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhis salam could hear them, and this is the Prophet of Bani Israel, is nowhere in comparison to the reality of Sayyidina Muhammad ﷺ. They're but like a drop in the reality of the Muhammadan kingdom. So what did Prophet ﷺ describe of his awliya and his ulama? That they inherit from the station of the Prophets of Bani Israel. So if Sayyidina Sulaiman had that power, is Sulaymaniyya that Prophet ﷺ give to all his awliya in their rank and in their darajat, and it's not something hard. So people whom debate these subjects and ridiculous subjects of the level of the knowledge of Prophet ﷺ, there is no understanding of the level of knowledge, because it encompasses all knowledges, and that little of which it will be disclosed, and that's by permission of Prophet ﷺ. But what he gave to us is that my ulama are inheritors, warithul anbiya bani Israel. So look to the examples that Allah is giving of the Prophets of Bani Israel and what power Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhis salam had. He had command of the jinn, command of the shayateen and the ifrit, command of malaika, command of all the creatures and birds and ants, that he could hear their speech and he could command them. So then imagine the immense power that Sayyidina Muhammad, because Nur Muhammad, everything is a communication through energy, through light. When the heart is operating from the kingdom of light, it can tune into any frequency, any communication that coming out is going to be brought to the common denominator. So that when you communicate with your tongue, the communication and the reality of your communication is only a vibration and intention that first occurs in the heart. It's not originating here, it's originating within the heart. The energy of what you're about to say is coming up, and then through your mouth is the final appearance of what you've said. But the energy of what you're talking about is coming out as energy and lights. So the one whom reaches the common denominator and reaches to the oceans of energy and oceans of light, then through their light they merely gaze at anything, and all this communication will be understood according to their darajats and what Allah wants to give to them. Those are achieved in seclusions. They're not needed in this dunya to walk around and to be bombarded with the communication of everything and the overload to the human experience. But when Allah wants it to open, they've been shown and taught that how it would be opened. That they merely operate through their light and they focus their light on a duck, a goose, or anything that's walking, and immediately its thoughts and its understanding is being sent out, and through their light they can pick up its understanding, what it's communicating. And this was the intentional dalil that Allah was revealing through Surah An-Naml to show about the kingdom, Sulaimaniyya reality. Sulaiman means Sulaiman has its own reality and its huruf, and it shows on what knowledges were being conveyed, that he was speaking to these creatures, understanding their languages, communicating with the cricket, communicating with the ants. And Qur'an is an ocean that's infinite, and anybody who wants to understand these qissas, that they only started with the Qur'an, but ulama, they retrieve these knowledges from the Holy Prophet ﷺ, holy companions, the tafsirs of Ibn Abbas that were later, all its realities were brought out by Imam Tabari, which has long descriptions of the histories of the Prophets of Allah. And the communication that Sayyidina Sulaiman was communicating with creatures, he was communicating with the birds. He was having a wedding ceremony, and there's a story of a cricket that brought a grasshopper leg as a wedding ceremony for Sayyidina Sulaiman as-salam. That all kingdoms were coming and bringing their treasures for the wedding of Sayyidina Sulaiman as-salam to pay homage and respect. And in that line of people there was a cricket, and the cricket was carrying with all his strength the leg of a grasshopper. And by the time he appeared into the presence of Sayyidina Sulaiman, and in the writings of Tabari, this is showing the immensity of his power. He's looking at the cricket and understanding the communication with it. And he said, "Thank you very much for your gift, but you can see that I have a huge kingdom and a huge army, this is very small." And he said, "Oh Rasulullah, that we are people of faith. I'm bringing you the best of what my community has and what we have to offer, and Allah is great. By merely you accepting it, Allah inshaAllah make it sufficient for everyone to eat from." And at that moment he presented the leg of the grasshopper, and Sayyidina Sulaiman thanked Allah, realized it doesn't matter what's coming, whatever's coming is from Allah. As soon as he thanked Allah, the leg of the grasshopper immediately immensely grew, and grew big enough for all his men to eat from it. Wow. means that so many of these realities and so many of these qissas are taught by awliya, because it's not just that you read the ayatul kareem or holy surah and you stopped with there. But there's many, many stories and realities behind the surahs and the lives of these prophets that give us the understanding of who Sayyidina Muhammad is. So back to the understanding of the ant with all its smallness, what type of power it has to communicate, what type of community that it builds that they operate as a unit of one. They move together, they climb if they need to climb something, they even they cross water as a unit. They all lock onto each other and they make a bridge so that their whole community can cross. So I mean in this way of marifah, for Allah to put the significance of an ant at the title of the surah is to remind us, this way of realities is not based on the head. This way of realities is not by, you know, logical deduction and using your head, because the ant doesn't have a head. We don't really even know which side is the head. But it has to have the immensity of a heart and faith. And all of Allah's creatures that have this immense power, the power of a dolphin in which it sends echocardiograms and echosonic beats throughout the ocean, the bird in which has no head like a pea but has an immense heart and flies thousands of feet in the air. All of these creatures are giving us an example that in this way of marifah it's not about the head but it's about conditioning the head to shut off and opening the reality of the heart. That the more you use the head the less the heart becomes active, because you're trying to logically understand and the brain is not the place for these realities. It's the heart that has to be built, the reality of the heart, the reality of energy, the reality of communicating with the heart and its infinite capacity. We pray that Allah in these beatific nights and days open for us its understanding, that Allah puts that reality of the ant right on the path of this marifah to remind us that don't come with your head. Try as much in life to negate the head and open the heart. That's why the first zikr of every tariqah is La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah. That no God but Allah. Means that to negate everything but Allah and bring the light of this reality within the heart, and that there's nothing in my head, that make the head to be empty. Learn to teach the head not to think about it, to take the reality and to make it to be real within the heart and not to bring it up and analyze it within the head. The more that the servant can negate their head and open their heart, then the more the head becomes like a moon, which we talked last night. Is that if your head is trying to act like the sun and the source of knowledge is, and that's why all these TV shows is about the head. They say, oh, we're going to transfer consciousness to your head. They think that teletransportation and energy movement is through your head. That will send your consciousness to your head, to your head. No, but Allah's consciousness and Allah's realities are being sent by hearts. And they don't talk about the heart because they've taught everybody to turn off their heart. And they told everybody to use their head because the dunya is upside down in its understanding. And the heavens is coming to teach us, turn off your head and use your heart. Your head can achieve nothing, there's no energy that can come to it, there's no teletransporting from your head, there's no movement of haqiqat and ta'i, there's no nothing through the head. The head has to be negated, and as a result of negating the head and not thinking through the head but just to sami'na wa ata'na, I heard the reality and my belief is to believe in it, Ya Rabbi open my heart. At that point the heart becomes empowered with these lights and these realities and begins to shine its light upon the head. And that's what we want, is the active head to be shut off and the light and the power of the heart to illuminate the ears so that it's hearing from the power of the heart. To illuminate the eyes means the normal faculty of your hearing you have to learn to shut off. The normal faculty of your seeing you have to negate and close your eyes. The normal faculty of your senses, your mouth and your breath, they have to be shut off. When you learn to shut them off and learn to empower the heart and bring the light into the heart, the faith into the heart, what happens then? The heart begins to empower the hearing, and that's the hadith al-Qudsi. Because qalbul mu'min baytullah, not maghz al-mu'min, not the brain of the mu'min, the qalbul mu'min. Means that when Allah's light begins to occupy the heart and this nurul iman begins to occupy the heart, this light begins to shine within the ears and their hearing becomes of a Divinely hearing in which they hear their consciousness, they hear what they need to do. Before you try to hear the heavens and angels and all of these things, it's do you first hear yourself? What are your commands? What did you promise Allah? Are you moving towards those? If you can't hear yourself, why do you want to hear angels? People do the emailing, how do we hear angels? How can we hear Prophet? What sound would the sound of Prophet come? And who could carry that level of energy and sound? So it means that the teaching for us is if you can't hear yourself, why are you thinking of going above that? So the first level of this consciousness is I have to hear, I have to open my heart and I have to hear what Allah has commanded for me. What did Allah want for me? Am I on a mission to fulfill my covenant? Are you sitting at home and you're just working and you're just sleeping and you're just eating and the days of your life are passing, some are in nice cars and less nicer cars and nice jewelry and whatever it is, you're just passing life on a daily basis, but do you feel that you're any closer to your command from Allah? What was your purpose to come into this world? Means then when they begin to hear and meditate and, Ya Rabbi, what is it that you want from me? What is it that should I be doing? And purify my heart, purify my character, they begin to understand the command from Allah through their consciousness. And then Allah dresses their eyes because they close their eyes to the material world, they don't trust it, they don't like it, they feel deceit is everywhere, they feel falsehood is everywhere. They don't have to attack people and fight people because of that, they just have to close their eyes to it, shut yourself off from it. That's why we're not a people that make comments, oh this one like this, this one. People feel that if they find something wrong they have to say something about it. So no, just close your eyes to it because everything in this dunya is going wrong. So these are the people whom they close their eyes often and they connect their heart. Then Allah sends that light from the heart into their eyes and they begin to see through their heart and not through the physical eyes. It's not that you close your eyes and you want to see the jinn running around in the room. It's a matter of that my eyes, Ya Rabbi, I'm filled up with it, I don't feel like looking anymore, all I see through these eyes is deceit. So I close my eyes and in my heart is the abode of heaven because baytullah qalb al-mu'min. I go into baytullah, we should go into baytullah and from that nur Allah now begin to look. Look through my heart, look through my house. Through Allah's house you see everything beatific and every reality begin to open. So it means these senses have to be opened from the reality of the heart. And these are through the practices and all the trainings, the meditation, the tafakkur, the contemplation. And we pray in this holy month the reality of Mawlid al-Nabi is every moment and every day. From the day we wake up in the morning we ask ourselves, Ya Rabbi, am I any closer to my purpose? And did I live my life on tashreef, tashreef al-Nabi, in glorifying the magnificent status of Allah and His beloved Sayyidina Muhammad. If I live my life for that, then my life has its purpose and its reality. And every day I try to fulfill that. I try to keep the company of those whom are doing that. I try to join on their train because I know their train is like a bullet train, it's moving into the reality and continuously moving on a cable, on a fixed cable into the heart of Sayyidina Muhammad like looping. It doesn't go off its track, it's locked onto that track and every year it's moving deeper into that reality and I spend my life trying to join that, be a part of that, participate into that reality and to be dressed by it. And so that every day is the Nabi and that every day is a beatific dress and reality upon ourselves. No matter how hard the dunya is, this love and muhabbat will sustain us. Without this love and without the training of this love, life is just difficult and sad, difficult and sad. And Allah has made a beatific garden and that's qalb al-mu'min in Baytullah. Anybody who wants to enter into this house of Allah is so simple. It's not a $15,000 ticket or a package with the first class hotels, it's right here. You don't have to have any ticket. You enter into your heart and you communicate and enter into that, you seek refuge in that reality to dress you from every sadness and every difficult. Every sadness that now is on earth is a means in which to draw closer to Allah. That when people are, you know, everything is fantastic for them, they become heedless. And when things are not opening and not being granted and they feel a sadness from difficulties in their life, then Allah is calling you, go into your heart, go into your meditation, go in and ask into the presence of Sayyidina Muhammad and see yourself at his feet and that your forehead is at the feet of Sayyidina Muhammad and give your request that every night cry out and ask for a nearness, an opening, that the difficulty to be taken away, the visa to be granted, whatever it is that you're praying for, you should have your forehead at the feet of Prophet. No one else can help you and if you're not there asking for that, then maybe it's still not difficult enough. This is their training, that the difficulty comes as a result of them wanting something and what they want is the nearness, the ashiqeen. They're continuously in a state of brokenheartedness and their only refuge, their only safety is at the feet of Sayyidina Muhammad and that they're in that love asking Prophet please that you ask Allah provide an opening, provide my rizq, provide my faith, provide good character, whatever the person is praying for. We pray that Allah dress us and bless us. Bless all those whom are commenting, participating, sharing the feeds and participating on all the platforms. Those whom support the store, they could support 500 different stores. This is obvious, we're not Costco. We're doing this to support our projects. Those whom get the books, they could read 1,000 different books but these books are based on these teachings. So by supporting it, you give the reason for somebody to make the books. We didn't make them for our own entertainment but they were supposed to be disseminated for people to read and live a life in which one day the internet won't be present and that won't be the time that you're going to decide to get it all. You have your staff, you have your ring, you have your tasbih, you have your book, you have your belief. You have everything of these resources and then one day you find all of it shut down and you're ready for whatever's coming. But the one whom said, no, later, 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 well we saw that all our life, that later doesn't really work because later comes and you still won't be ready and you'll have missed that bus. We pray that Allah give us more and more understanding, more and more lights and more ishq and love and muhabbat inshaAllah. Subhana rabbika rabbal izzati amma yasifoon, as-salamu ala al-mursaleen, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Bi hurmati Muhammad al-Mustafa bi siri Surat al-Fatiha.